Hello, everybody. Welcome to my Wiley Solution walkthrough. This is Accounting Tools for Business Decision Making. This is the 8th edition. This is Exercise 1313. Textbook authors are Paul Kimmel, Jerry Weingett, and Jill Mitchell. Question used in the presentation is copyright 2023 by John Wiley & Sons. All rights are reserved. This is for educational purposes only. The video may not be distributed or redistributed without the express permission of Wiley. The solution presentation is copyright 2023 by Bennett Tchaikovsky. All rights are reserved. The opinions contained within this presentation are those of myself and not the authors of the textbook or of Wiley. Before we come over here and thank the bus driver, a couple comments I just want to make to all of you is when it comes to ratios and financial statement analysis, this is, we're just trying to give you an introduction to it. This is a very complex topic. And it's not that it's complex, it's just that it's very layered. There's a lot of information you need to know. I'm writing a class on financial statement analysis right now, and it's a lot of information. So this one unit here could easily be its own class. When I teach this for my honors course at Irvine Valley College, I don't even give this on an exam. I have the students write a paper, just because I think it's a much better way to go through and to test the material. So as we look at this particular one over here, and before we get over here, the ratios, on my exam, what I would be doing is I would be saying, okay, which ratios would you choose? I would give you a list. Here they've got current ratio, inventory turnover, profit margin, return on assets, return on common shareholders' equity, debt to assets, and times interest earned. So the thing about this is that, there's a lot of ratios, but what I do on my exams is I will make you say, okay, here's a balance sheet, which ratios best analyze the company. In order for you to answer that question, the first thing you would have to go through and do is to perform a vertical analysis or preparing common sized financial statements. You would see which ones are the most prominent, and then you would go from there in terms of telling what you would want to go through and do. So with that all being said, let's go ahead and do what we're asked. The first one is going to be the current ratio. The current ratio is not an electrified ratio, but rather what it is we're taking our current assets divided by our current liabilities. This is what we call one of the liquidity ratios. I generally don't like this ratio because I think if you're really looking about liquidity, it's better to look at it in terms of you're better off looking at it or in terms of the acid test or the quick ratio. And there's this one thing I want to check right now with the solution, because I'm assuming, let's go over here, just give me a second. Okay, so we're gonna do this for 2 years. So we've got 2025 and then we have 2024. For 2024, my current assets were 1.3 billion. For 2025, there were 1 billion, 1.39 billion. My current liabilities were 820. And over here, this is 790. So when I look at this in terms of the ratio, what is my current ratio? What you'll do is you'll basically say, okay, this is 1.6 versus 1.6. So it really hasn't changed. It's relatively the same. So, but that's what the current ratio tells us. I personally don't like the ratio because it includes things like inventory, which can be tough to liquidate. But anyways, but that's how you go through and compute the current ratio. The next one is the inventory turnover ratio. This is actually a very important one. My inventory turnover ratio is going to be my cost of goods sold divided by my average inventory. Okay. So What we have to know though for average inventory, so the cost of goods sold in terms of the numerator, right? My cost of goods sold is $970 for 2025 and it is $890 for 2024. My average inventory is going to be my beginning plus my ending divided by two. My beginning inventory for 2025, right, is going to be 460 plus 390, right? My end of 2024 is the beginning of 2025. I'm taking these two results here, dividing by two, and this is going to give me what is that? 850 divided by two, 425. Okay. So my inventory turnover is 2.2 times per year. That means it's taking me around 180 days to sell my inventory. That is not a good thing. So, and just in terms of going through and interpreting it again, it's something that, you know, I'll talk about that a little bit more in class, but for purposes of doing this video, that is not a good ratio. Let's go ahead and do the average inventory for 2024. So the average inventory over here, it says that assume that the inventory in as of 2023, the ending one was a total of 340. So over here, what I'm going to go ahead and do is I'm going to say, right, this is going to be 340 plus, sorry, the ending, which is going to be 390 plus 340 divided by two. So this over here is going to be 365. Okay. Now for this ratio over here, this is again, it was turning over more quickly in the previous period. It's turning over less. That means you may have a problem with obsolescence. So, but again, it's one ratio, not going to be dispositive of everything. But let's go to the next one over here. So the next one is going to be our profit margin. As we talked about in the last video, that's also the same thing as the net margin. So the profit margin. And let's just go ahead and borrow from my previous work, which was so amazing, which is over here is going to be our net income divided by our net sales. Okay. So for 2025, this is going to be 252 divided by our net sales, which is 3,800. Over here, you've got 132 for 2024, and this is going to be divided by 3,460. So I can tell you off the bat, our profit margin looks better. But again, the inventory turnover would be a concern, but again, is inventory a significant portion of our balance sheet, right? So our profit margin has almost doubled from year to year. So again, that's a good thing. Okay. Over here, return on assets. Okay. So as we saw from the last video, my return on assets is basically going to be my beginning. The average is going to be my net income divided by the average total assets. And so let's put this over here. So return on assets. Okay. So over here, the net income was 252, 132 over here. My average total assets are going to be my beginning plus my ending divided by two. It tells us over here that the assets on 12/31/23 was 1900. That's a very important number because I need that in order to basically figure out my for 2024. So my average total assets for 2025 is going to be 23,340, 22,010. I'm going to take these two over here. I'm going to divide it by two. My average total assets are 2 million or 2.2 billion. So right over here, this is going to be my return on assets is going to be about 11%. My total, my return on assets for the 2024 tells me that my ending assets on 12/31/23 was 1900. So this over here is going to be 1900, 2210. So my average total assets over here was 2,210 or 2.2 billion. And so this is about 5%. So my total asset turnover, or my return on assets is also improved. Okay, next one over here is return on stockholders' equity. Stockholders' equity common was 900. I have no idea why they're telling us that, but let's take a look. Okay. Oh, for the prior year. Okay. So by the way, this shouldn't say common. This should just say owner's equity. And this hasn't really changed from year to year. Okay. So again, for my return on shareholders' equity, it's going to be my net income minus my preferred dividends. And this one, there are no preferred dividends. Okay. So my net income is going to be the 252. And this over here is going to be 132. There are no preferred dividends. If you're taking my class, I will not ask you about preferred dividends. If you're taking somebody else's class, ask them to show you a publicly traded company, like more than one, that uses preferred stock, and you'll find out really quickly that the SEC does not like it. Okay. So over here, my average shareholders' equity is going to be 1,040,000. Why is that? Because if it's the average and it hasn't changed from period to period, there's really nothing I need to do here, right? But for 2024, the shareholders' equity was 900. So what I'm going to do over here is I'm going to say, okay, my average shareholders' equity okay, it was 1040, and this is 900. Okay, so my return on shareholders' equity is going to be, it's definitely going to be an improvement, about 24%. And then here it was about 13%. So we're seeing a lot of doubling in our numbers. And now we get to the fun stuff. Okay. So the next one over here is my debt to assets ratio. What is debt to assets? Let's go ahead and look it up. And let's see what they're defining debt here as. Okay. So when you see debt to assets, so this is like total, another way of saying debt to assets, you want to say total liabilities divided by total assets. And this is just really an indicator of how leveraged a company is. So over here, my total liabilities for 2025 are going to be the current liabilities plus the non-current liabilities. My total assets for this right over here for 2025 is going to be 2340. So this is going to be roughly 55%. Again, this is a good or bad ratio. This depends on the company. Over here, my total liabilities for 2024 were 790 plus 380. My total assets for 2024 were $2.2 billion and over here. So I've become a little bit more leveraged during the year, meaning my liabilities have gone up. Okay, so that's debt to assets. Now, the next one over here is times interest earned. This is a very, very important ratio. So when we go through and look at times interest earned, also known as the interest, also this is known as the interest coverage ratio. This is defined as earnings before interest, depreciation, and taxes. Let's go up here. Okay, so basically is earnings before interest and taxes divided by the total interest payable on bonds and other debt. Okay, so right over here, so times interest earned. Let's kind of put this over here on the side. So my times interest earned is going to be my earnings before taxes. Okay, so over here, what is that going to be? This is going to be my earnings before taxes for 2025. This is going to be 3,800 minus 970 minus 2,400. Or another way of saying this is showing it, this is going to be a total of 430. Okay. I'm then going to basically divide this by 10, which is the amount of my interest expense. Okay, so my times interest earned ratio for 2025 is going to be 43 times. What does that mean? I'm earning enough where I can go through and cover my interest payments by a factor of 43. So if somebody's loaning money to me, they don't have to worry about me necessarily being able to pay them back. Over here, so this is earnings before taxes, and this is going to be divided by my interest expense payable. So for 2024, this is going to be my earnings before taxes are 3460 minus 890 minus 2330. Or this is going to be over here, this will be 3460 minus 890 minus 2330 divided by 20. And for this one over here, this is actually, we've gotten better. Because over here, this, my times interest earned is roughly 12. So I've gone from a position where I'm making significantly more profit to cover any type of interest payment. So this is actually a good thing. So those are the ratios that we were asked to go through and to compute. Again, this is a very small snapshot in terms of what we go through and do for ratio analysis. But I always think it's a good thing to kind of go through and review how to go through and to do these types of questions. So I want to thank Wiley today for allowing me to use their content, specifically their questions to provide you these solutions. And if there's anything else you'd like to see, please feel free to ask. Have a great day, and I look forward to seeing you on future videos. Have a good one.